that's the other side. Wow, how things come full circle, right? It was, first of all, welcome to the school. My story is nowhere near as exciting as that. I just have to say, at the end of the 90s, my involvement in this crazy-looking car that was Viper, and a couple of the people here, Rick and co, were along for that ride right in the early days. And, you know, it, as a driver, you're a young driver, to be part of a program that is in GT racing, using the car that is kind of one of the hottest things, the most unique things on the market, is a really special and slightly rare occurrence. And we literally laid waste to the opposition around the world, whether it was, you know, in Italy at Monza, where we raced at Silverstone. It was a true FIA World GT Championship, and it was, and the story of how I won it was a longer one, but, you know, it was so dominant, and you really felt you were, I mean, for a British guy to be part of an American team spearheading this global sort of motorsport attack was incredible. And then to win Le Mans, and after my father had won it all those times, and then win the World Championship, it was an incredibly cool thing. And then, of course, like all good things, it ended. And yet the cult and the legacy remained, which I think is the important part. And then they came back into racing, and then they went away. But all through it, throughout it, there's been this passionate following for all things Viper. And yeah, it's a polarizing car, we know that. But it's a car that almost unilaterally, it doesn't matter whether Ferrari owners or Porsche drivers or Lamborghini owners, everyone's kind of intrigued to get behind the wheel. They might not want to own one, but they definitely want to try it. Which sort of leads us to the group in here a little bit. I know most of you. I kind of do what you do as well. And I know that the range of experience that we have in this room ranges from people that actually hold almost racing licenses to the rest of us that have, you know, rest of you that have amazing experience out there driving the world's best cars in the craziest locations. But this is truly a unique setup. To come here where you have this car, or this range of cars, certainly with the Hellcats, that almost you can't drive anywhere else in the world, where you certainly can't drive them unleashed, unfettered, on a track that's certainly perfect for it, with the organization and the structure of Bondurant that will allow you to go pretty quick. The other side to it is there are probably people in the room that might have been doing an app building webinar yesterday, and suddenly you've gone from virtual reality to reality, a very real reality. Not everyone is a high performance aficionado, and I think what is important for us is that you're going to get a lot from this as well. For those of us that know it and walk the walk, you know, driving fast is an aphrodisiac. It's an incredibly engaging side of life. And in a world where, you know, everything's low fat, and low emissions, and low fun, this is kind of a pretty cool way to get your rocks off, really. And it's almost like it's un-PC to say that you should go somewhere and be so in touch with raw horsepower, but that's what we're doing here. Pat did touch on it. The kind of people that come to the school is a broad spectrum, and again, that probably touches for certainly as we go through the week. Other sort of media colleagues are coming more from lifestyle magazines, and can you imagine what it's like if you aren't exposed to this? You might be thinking this might not be the thing for me. Well, that's the kind of student that they have here. You know, billionaires fly their friends in on jets to do Bondurant. You have the guy that goes to every racing school. There's guys that come here and just literally are repeat offenders. They just come through every month, every quarter on another program. And then there's the guy that literally has saved up for 2 years to come and do the school. And it's just an experience. It's a bucket list thing. Driving a Viper, I mean, the Hellcats, I know a lot of you have already driven them for your publications. Driving them here is something different. You're able to really enjoy the horsepower. You're certainly not afraid of going a little sideways. Driving the Vipers you actually feel like you've been strapped onto the back of a very large beast that initially you don't feel you have control of, but once you work with the instructors and if you listen to them, you very much have full control over it. The way I want to, a little sort of heads up on how to deal with this is, the instructors here, I have never seen a group of people led by Mike, who you'll hear from in a little bit. They are perhaps the bravest souls on the planet, but they're brave because they've they know what they're doing and they're confident in Bob's teaching methodology, you will be rewarded for getting their trust. And we all do programs, well, I'm in the latest McLaren shit sitting behind someone and leave and follow. They don't do that here once you get going. You really will never have driven someone else's car this fast, providing you show the due respect. So my heads up would be, gain their trust and they will let you drive to the limits or the cars or whichever comes first. It sometimes is a bit of a toss up. Enjoy, make the most of the day. This is truly a unique opportunity. I'm very proud to be involved. I'm gonna be here throughout the day. We all have lots of war stories. Mine involved getting very hot and sweaty behind the wheel of that car there. That was obviously not taken in 1997. You know, I'll tell you at lunchtime some stories about what it was like to drive these cars, but suffice to say, it touches something visceral in all of us. And whether you like the car, you don't like the cars, this is something that is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. But for a lot of people, it'll be their first opportunity. So enjoy your day, guys. And, well, here comes Rick.